You can use the same sleeves the best players in the world use, Channel Fireball sleeves. And what better way to carry them than in a Channel Fireball deck box? And if you want to play like the best, you have to dress like the best. Channel Fireball shirts, hats, hoodies, and more are all available in the apparel section of ChannelFireball.com. Head to ChannelFireball.com/store to find all of your gaming supplies.
Hey everyone, welcome to a Theros draft. This pack is unfortunately not that great. The best cards in the pack are Ill-Tempered Cyclops, because it's pretty reasonable for a 3-3, only costing 4 mana, and Monstrosity is not terribly expensive at 6 mana, so it can get out of hand pretty quickly. It's certainly not one to fight with. There's also a Hopeful Eidolon, which is pretty reasonable to suit up to some random creature and make a large Baneslayer Angel. And there's also a Sealock Monster, which is kind of expensive, but it definitely becomes pretty large. Overall, I'm going to take the Ill-Tempered Cyclops. Red isn't my favorite color, but this is a little bit better than the other options, I believe. Now, looking at this pack, you can see that there's a rare missing. So, looking at the other cards, I'm not too much of a fan of the Evangel, just because you need cards to make it the tokens pretty good, like Phalanx Leader. And without that, 1/1s really just aren't that great. Best card in the pack is the Nessian Asp by a fair margin. Just a giant creature, and being able to block anything makes it pretty difficult to deal with. There's also a Vaporkin, which is pretty good. It's a 2-drop. There's a Baneful Eidolon and Nessian Courser. Those are all a little bit worse than the Nessian Asp, and by a little I mean by a fair margin, so yeah. Alright, well, it seems like black may be open. There are quite a few black cards here, and there are also quite a few white cards, so, and some green cards. So it would seem that red-blue is not exactly the color combination to be in, and between the black cards, there's Lash of the Whip and Cavern Lampad. And Lash is not that bad. Problem is it's pretty expensive, but it is an instant, so you can definitely make some tricky plays in combat. And the Lampad is pretty good also. It does bestow for 6, which when being paired with Grink, can get a little bulky. Lash is also, and falls in that similar problem, but overall I think it's a little bit better. Now this pack, you can see that there is, unfortunately, not much green, but there is white still. So, given that white is open, there's Vanquish the Foul, which is pretty expensive, restrictive, and slow. And there's also an Evangel. Not really too fond of either of those. If we want to stay out of white for the moment, we can take a March of the Returned or a loathsome beast. I still have no idea how to pronounce its actual name. But in any case, I think it would be good to take one of the non-blue cards, because blue seems like it's a bit of a trap. And this Ill-Tempered Cyclops just seems like it's going to be running around for a little bit, and we're not going to take anything. So I think we'll go ahead and take the Evangel, just because white seems like it's pretty open, and if it is, then the Evangel ends up making a lot of tokens, so hopefully it can actually do something. This pack, you can see that there's white and black. There's a God's Willing, and Freak is Cure, and Sentry of the Underworld. Given that white and black are open, we can take the Sentry, or the God's Willing. Actually, my least favorite cards are the Band Elder, the Laguna Band Elder, and the Farika's Cure. There's also a Rage of Purphoros, which, again, is pretty slow, like the Vanquish the Foul. So I'm less likely to want to play this. I'm more likely to want to go into black-white, and it would seem that Sentry of the Underworld is actually the best, most powerful card overall, so it has the biggest payoff. Now, this pack is unfortunately not too full of options that are that go well with our picks. There is a Feral Invocation in case that we actually end up just ending up in green, or there is also a we can take a white creature. We can take a Cavalry Pegasus or Citizen Griffin. If we're not green, then the Griffin is pretty mediocre, but between the two, the Pegasus is the weaker. And there aren't really too many humans that to give for this to give flying to. So I'm more inclined to take the Griffin, although it is very easy to get expensive cards. But in this case, I think the Griffin is going to win out. Now, with this pack, you can see there's just some stuff, not too much. Overall, I think Anvil Raptor is the safest pick, whereas the Centaurs is the most, gives you the most value for your mana. 3/7 is definitely huge and very difficult to kill in combat, barring some giant monstrous creature. But given that our picks are spread out over four colors and our signals it's been difficult to decipher them somewhat, we're going to go ahead and just take the artifact, and because it'll end up making our deck almost regardless. Now, Phalanx is the best card. Unfortunately, if you're not playing blue and can't attack with it, it loses a lot of value. But still, if we end up having a deck that has a high curve, then the Phalanx is going to be pretty reasonable. There's also Glare of Heresy as a sideboard option, and that is definitely something to consider. It's a very powerful sideboard card, and I think it would be better than the Phalanx overall. Now we're back here with the option of taking another Raptor or a Dark Betrayal. I haven't seen any green so far, and it's red has been slightly represented more. So it seems like going with Dark Betrayal is going to be a reasonable pick compared to the Raptor. If you do a cost sort quickly, then you can see our curve is pretty high, so there's reasons for taking both, but the Raptor is going to win out in this case just because the number of picks we have are somewhat low. And now we can just take a Wheel of the Returned or a Boon of Erebros. And the Boon is actually a reasonable combat trick just because it's only one mana, whereas it's much more likely to be able to pick these up later on in the draft. So we're going to take the Boon and go into black-white. Now here we can take a Fleshmad Steed, or we can take a Last Breath. And I'm more likely to take the Last Breath, even though I don't like playing it a lot of the time. It is a good card against very cheap decks, decks with small creatures. Or we could take Unknown Shores, but that is less likely to be good than a sideboard removal spell. And there you have it, March of the Returned. And now we can just take a Lost in the Labyrinth, lost as much as we are in this draft. So this pack was pretty rocky. We started off in red, and then green, and then went into black, and then white, and ended up in black-white. So we ended up wasting a few first picks, but that's just the way things are going to go sometimes because of the way the draft dynamic works. So in this pack, probably going to go with Fabled Hero. It is quite large, difficult to deal with, and if you have a lot of ways to target it, like by a Leaf Crown Dryad or other bestow cards or auras, you can get out of hand. It's one of the best cards in the set and can do a lot of damage out of nowhere. So we're just gonna windmill slam this and not really think much else of it. There's not too much else in the pack that we would be interested in, so we're pretty happy with that. S-Pack has quite a few cards. I'm not really interested in taking the Farika's Cure, just because we don't know what the breakdown of our mana base is going to be. If we end up being heavy white, then this becomes quite awkward, and as a late game spell, it is pretty ineffective. Better cards include God's Willing and Hopeful Eidolon. And between Hopeful Eidolon and God's Willing, I would prefer to take the God's Willing, simply because it is very good against all of the expensive removal in the pack, in the set, like Vanquishes the Foul and Sip of Hemlock, Lash of the Whip, and so on. So we're going to take this and be happy. Hopefully we wheel one of these black/white cards, and there are enough in here as to where we should. Now here we can take another Lash of the Whip. There's also an Observant Ulseid, which ends up being pretty good with a lot of the white creatures, like Fabled Hero and anything that gets a bonus from being targeted. Wheeling this pack, I would assume that the Dark Betrayal is going to come back. The Disciple should not, just because the first one from pack one didn't. There are enough white cards in here to make it so that this is heavy enough to where we should expect another playable out of this, which is good. Now this is a pretty solid pick for us, Erebos's Emissary. This creature is actually pretty problematic because it really deals with hidden information and it makes it very difficult for your opponent to block because they just have no idea how many creatures you're going to have in your hand. And it really gives you a lot of free room as far as making attacks because it's just very, very easy to take advantage of a bad block. The opponent may not want to risk the possibility of losing more than one creature in combat. Now here we can take an Observant Alcyid. There's also Scourge Mark and Chosen by Heliod. Those cheaper options are better in decks that have a lot of heroic cards, but for the average deck, the Alcyid is going to function a little bit better. And here there's a bunch of removal, but we already have two Lash of the Whip, so I'm more likely to take the Baleful Eidolon, just because it's quite difficult to beat through this. And generally, if the creature that you're bestowing this onto is large enough that they have to throw two creatures to trade with it, then it becomes quite good, and you can grind out your opponent pretty well with it. And you still have the Eidolon afterwards, so it's going to become a 3-for-1, which is not that bad. Now here we can take there's a Band Elder, there's Return Phalanx, Battlewise Valor, or Traveler's Amulet. Currently we don't have any cards that we want to splash, and trying to get double green for this guy is just not realistic. So taking a look at our curve, you can see that we only have a Baleful Eidolon on 2, and Fabled Hero and the Alcyid on 3, so our curve is a bit high. So we can definitely play one of these Band Elders. It's not the best creature, but if you have an aura on the battlefield, then you can definitely generate a little bit of a tempo swing and will fit in the curve quite nicely. Now there's an Theros Warden. I'm not really a fan of this because it's very expensive and it's going to be slightly worse than the Ordeal. The Ordeal can definitely take over a game, especially when you have cheap creatures and are on the play. Whereas the Warden is just not really good at blocking at all, so you can't actually sort of moat something the turn that you summon it. And so it just ends up being very, very slow and not really great. Now in this pack there's a Cutthroat from Nowhere, which is on the expensive side. I prefer the Chosen by Heliod simply because it makes creatures more difficult to attack through, and it's a good trigger for heroic because it cycles, and it's also good for devotion, so we're gonna go with that. I would like the combat trick if we're actually just a little bit cheaper, but 4 mana is just quite a bit. And here we can take a Flamecast Wheel. We already have one March of the Return, and it seems likely that we can pick up another one, whereas if we need more removal, then we'll have the option of bringing this in. Now, between Dark Betrayal and Ray of Dissolution, I would prefer to run the Ray main deck, whereas Betrayal is a better sideboard card. Currently, I would take this and play it in the main, so we'll go ahead and do that. And we can take a Prowler's Helm in case we run into matchups where there are a lot of creatures that we can't attack through. So overall, this pack was much better, and given that we're fairly entrenched into black-white, I can only hope that pack 3 is going to be the same. We didn't really pass too much in terms of sweet cards. There were a few that managed to slip by, but given the pack dynamic from the first pack, I can only imagine that this pack 3 will be pretty good for us.